All right. We'll talk today about the good guys, the bad guys, and the good guys. I like to let the good guys come in first. You know, that's how the movie goes. The good guy shows up at the beginning, then the bad guy comes up and scares you to death, and then the good guy shows up again and saves everything. And so I'm going to talk to you about the good guys, bad guys, good guys. Some of the things that you've heard about them that are not true, and some of the things that you have not heard about them that are true, and then some things you have not heard about them that are true. That's talking about the good guys, bad guys, good guys. One of the things you ever have, how many of you ever heard about a fellow by the name of Desiderius Erasmus? Have you ever heard the name Erasmus mentioned? All right, now you probably know that Erasmus has a great deal in the existence of the Textus Receptus, and he's one of our guys, you might say. And you probably also heard that he was a good Roman Catholic. How many of you ever heard anything bad said about him or that he was a good Roman Catholic? Let me see your hands. All right. I don't have the letter. I have it in my files. My files are in a pile, and the pile is buried under 400 boxes in a room back in Ohio. And so I have no way of getting the letter out right now. But some years ago, who was the guy? Panosian, down at Bob Jones University, wrote a letter, wrote an article in Faith for the Family, Bob Jones' publication. And he wrote this thing, and he said he talked about Westcott and Hort and how good they were, and how Erasmus was a Roman Catholic, and therefore the Textus Receptus, which really was not named until some years later, but that the Textus Receptus had to be Roman Catholic because a Roman Catholic had so much to do with it. Now, he never mentioned anything about the fact that Westcott and Hort used a Vatican manuscript or anything like that. And I wrote Bob Jones a third letter, and it was, I tried to be nice. Of course, every time I try, I end up falling, but I said this. I said, if Dr. Panosian wrote everything that he knew, he wasn't qualified to write the article. And if he wrote everything, if he didn't write everything he knew, then he wasn't honest enough to write the article. And Bob Jones III wrote two things in that letter that stand out still to this day. The one thing he said, I'd mentioned that the Pope had the Vatican manuscripts, and that who knows what he might have ever done with them because he didn't let anybody see him. And one thing Bob Jones III said was there are many great literary works in the Pope in the Vatican Library. Are you saying that the Pope has altered them all? Honey, this ain't a great literary work. Okay? Shakespeare is a great literary work. This is a great literary work. This is not a great literary work, okay? I don't know. I don't think the Pope is threatened at all by Shakespeare. I don't think he's threatened at all by what some of the historians and literature writers of centuries past have said. I think he's worried about this one. I worry about a man who heads up the university who thinks this is a great literary work. And the second thing he said, and this was almost like a couple of kids arguing, he says, Erasmus was as good a Catholic as there ever was. But here's what he said, just like that, you know. And so I thought, well, okay, I couldn't tell you whether he was or wasn't. I really couldn't. So I read a couple of books on Erasmus. I figured we'll find out, you ought to dig into it. So I read a couple of books on Erasmus for the book that I'm just finishing up. And I'm going to tell you some things about Erasmus, okay? And you know what I found out? I found out he wasn't as good a Catholic as ever lived. That's what I found out. All right, for all you who can't spell it, it's Erasmus. Okay, he was a 16th century humanist. Now, I know you say, well, humanists are bad. Well, yes, they are today. But at that time, do you know what a humanist was trying to do? A humanist was trying to free the humans from the Roman Catholic Church. Remember, the time that Erasmus lived, two things were true. Number one, there was no organized opposition. A reformation had not happened at the time that Erasmus lived, so there was nothing to go to. And the second thing was that Erasmus exalted humanity in that he felt that people had a right to decide their own destiny, to be free from much of the hierarchy and the tyranny of the church, the Roman Catholic Church. That's where his humanism showed. All right? He was an illegitimate child of a man who later became a priest. He was not a priest at the time. He was born in 1466 and had a brother. His father and mother died at a young age, died of the plague, and him and his brother were given to an uncle to raise, and the uncle at 9 years old, when Erasmus was nine, the uncle just wanted to unload him and his brother, so he put them both in a monastery. Now, Erasmus later chose to be an Augustinian monk, or an Augustinian priest. The reason he did that was because he knew the Augustinians had the best libraries, and this guy wanted to study. He was known for his charm, his wit, and his intellect. He studied at Paris, Oxford, the Netherlands, and Italy. He was probably the most famous author and scholar of his day, and one of the most prolific writers of all time. This is his relationship to the Roman Catholic Church. He never kept a vigil. He ate meat. In fact, he ate meat on Friday. They used to say that Erasmus was the only man. He was a Catholic heart and a Protestant stomach because he'd eat meat every Friday. He didn't care. He was ordained a priest in 1492, but he never functioned as a priest. He was never known to function as a priest, never accepted it. He berated the popes, priests, and monks for their overindulgence. He stated this, that a monk would not touch money, but was not so intolerant concerning wine and women. He attacked clerical concubinage. At that time, it was well known, it still happens, it's not well known now, that priests would keep women. All right? I mean, that's just what they did. They kept women. And he attacked that openly. He denounced the cruelty with which the Roman Catholic Church treated so-called heretics. And at one point, he even saved the man from the Inquisition. The Inquisition, as you know, as you remember, all somebody had to do was make a charge against you, and the Roman Catholic Church took you, and when they got done questioning you, you said you did it, whether you did it or not. He wrote a few works against the Roman Catholic Church. One called Praise of Folly, where he just exposes the folly of the Roman Catholic Church. One that was against the tactics that they used against their opposition was called Against the Barbarians. Sounds like a good Roman Catholic, doesn't it? Write a book like that about his own church. And Pope Julius, who at that time knew better how to use a sword than a Bible, when there was a tract that came out that was anonymous, and it was a parody that showed Pope Julius going to hell. He showed up at Heaven's Gate, and there was St. Peter, and Peter said, you know, I ain't letting you in. He said, well, I'm Pope Julius, don't you know who I am? And Peter sends the Pope to hell. That tract was written anonymously, but everybody said that the hand of Erasmus was all over it. Here's what he said of Pope Julius. He said, how truly is Julius playing the part of Julius? And what he meant was Julius Caesar, the great Roman conqueror. This is also what he said about Pope Julius. This monarchy of the Roman pontiff is a pest of Christendom. Sounds like good Roman Catholic. I'll tell you something. You want to see a difference? I'm going to read you a difference. If I can find it. He also made this statement. He said that the Roman Catholic Church needs to get rid of the Roman See. In other words, they need to get rid of the Pope and everything else. Now, here's a guy that says the Roman pontiff is the pest of Christendom, right? Now, this thing was written clear back in, some centuries ago. What I'm about to read you, it was written October 2nd, 1987. This is free. This wasn't part of the lesson, but I'll give this to you. I'll tell you who wrote it in a minute. Dear Christian bookstore owner, Pope John Paul II will never become a Baptist. That was a man of hope. And it is for sure that I will never convert to Roman Catholicism. However, I have stated often that I believe this Pope is a man of unique character and courage. This is Baptist writing this. Did you see what the Catholic said about the Pope? This one's written by a Baptist. His consistent stand on moral and social issues has provided the world leadership so desperately needed at this hour. Robert Evans is the Cecil B. DeMille of his generation, which is nothing to be proud of, hon. It should be, then, no marvel that Mr. Evans has so perfectly captured the innermost person and principles of Pope John Paul II. When I first watched The Power of Faith, I was deeply moved. I'd be moved all the way over my American Standard Version. While the Pope and I have broad doctrinal and theological differences, this man's commitment to the dignity of human life and his strong opposition to tyranny and bigotry provide a shining light for the people of our generation who need such reinforcement. The Power of Faith is not a Roman Catholic film. No, I imagine this isn't a Roman Catholic letter either. Mr. Evans is using his magical and unparalleled abilities to convey the message of love, forgiveness, and respect for human life, born and unborn. I think people from all faiths and walks of life will appreciate this film. Sincerely, Jerry Falwell. That's what a Baptist said about the Pope. I'd take what the Catholic said, wouldn't you? This guy says the Pope is the pest of Christendom. This Baptist said he's just such a nice man. All right? Erasmus published 5 editions of the New Testament. His first was in 1516. This consisted of a Greek text, his own Latin translation, and notes on the text. His second came in 1519, and that was similar, very similar to the first, except he made some revisions on the text. His third came in 1522. This one is significant to us. This is the first one. They put in 1 John 5, verse 7. I believe Erasmus wanted to put it in. He could not find a Greek manuscript that had it. He asked for one. Somebody found 2, so he put it in. His fourth edition came out in 1527, and his fifth came out in 1535. Now, the thing to remember is that when he did this, he put a Latin translation in with it and a Greek translation, a Greek text. Now, at the time that he did his own Latin translation, there was a Latin translation that was official. The official Latin translation used by the Roman Catholic Church. It was Jerome's Latin Vulgate from 480 AD. Erasmus refused to use it. You know why? He said that he was aware that manuscripts became corrupt in the 4th century, and he said there were some flaws in Jerome, and he wouldn't use it. Well, that made him popular with the Roman Catholic Church. Well, let me give you some other stuff. Give you an example. This is how Jerome translates Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, Jerome's Latin Vulgate. Do penance, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Now, what Catholic priest wouldn't be happy to hear that one? Erasmus translated the same verse, be penitent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. There's a big difference, right? They were talking last night about being penitent, right? Talk about repenting, not about doing penance. And there's a big difference. You may not see the difference, but if you're a Roman Catholic, you do, don't you? All right? Probably, and also he was a defender of Mark chapter 16, verses 9 through 21. Those verses, if you have a New American Standard Version or a New International Version, you'll find a footnote at verse 9, and it'll say that from there to verse 21, those verses were not found in the oldest manuscripts, the most ancient, however they want to word it, and they'll put some doubt on that. Erasmus was a defender of those. He was also a defender of John chapter 8, verses 1 through 12, the woman taken in adultery, called the Johnine Comma. Pericope de Adultera, I'm sorry. And he was a defender of that and believed it belonged in Scripture when others did not. Now, one of the greatest things that this guy did, I'll tell you something. You know, you get a guy with a mind like this, you know what you miss? You miss who he's taking care of. And the greatest contribution Erasmus made was that he was a champion of the common man. Now, at this time, the perfumed people, the people of the upper class, which Erasmus was, by the way, he was the leading scholar of his day, and they just didn't have to deal with the riffraff, okay? There was a classed society, and Erasmus was expected to be away from the common people. And here's what Erasmus did. Instead, he opened his arms completely and gave his work to the common man. He made this statement. He said he translated his Latin just so that a common man could have Scripture. Quote, I do think that the Scripture are fit, he's asking, do you think that the Scripture are fit only for the perfumed? Quote, I venture that anyone who reads my translation at home will profit thereby. He made this statement of who he wanted to have a Bible. And at this time, remember that the Turks had gone through Upper Africa, Northern Africa, and come across into Rome, into Italy and some places. And a Turk is probably our equivalent right now of an Iranian, or a communist, or a Nicaraguan, or a Cuban. Here's what he said. He wanted to see the Bible in the hands of, quote, the farmer, the tailor, the traveler, and the Turk. He later expanded that quotation to include the masons, the prostitutes, and the pimps. You know what this guy wanted? He wanted every man on face this earth to have a Bible in his language. I'd say that's commendable. It has often been said concerning Erasmus in the Reformation, it has often been said that Erasmus laid the egg that Luther hatched. People's true words never been spoken. You know, people say, well, why didn't Erasmus come out of the Roman Catholic Church? Erasmus had a problem with acceptance from the day he was a kid. I mean, lost his family. His uncle didn't want him. His parents couldn't acknowledge him. And the guy, all he ever wanted was to be accepted. But there was no place for him to go. It says this. I say this. The Reformation, when it started, they had his Bible. They had his Greek text. They had his writings. And they had his example of a man who would not bend to Rome. At one point, the Roman Catholic Church offered him the position of bishop, and he refused it. They said, if you'll be a bishop, and if you'll shut up, we'll make you a bishop. He said, I'll not be a bishop. Here's what he said about Martin Luther, the leader of the Reformation. Now, this is the leading Roman Catholic of his day beside the Pope. I want to tell you something. If Erasmus had set his mind to it, he wouldn't have been bishop. If Erasmus had set his mind to it, he would have been Pope. You mark it down. If he would have wanted to be, he would have been the Pope. All right, here's what he said of Luther. I favor Luther as much as I can, even if my cause is everywhere linked with his. He is known to have written several letters on Luther's behalf. He agreed with Luther that salvation was entirely by grace and not by works. Sound like a Roman Catholic? He rejected Roman Catholic pressure to engage Luther in oral or written debate. At one point, he left one town, Louvain, for Basel, rather than stand against a couple of Lutherans. And the only time he ever disagreed with Luther in writing was concerning Luther's doctrine of predestination, which you would probably disagree with Luther on. This is Erasmus' view of salvation. Now, if I ask a Catholic priest to show up here, now this guy's a Catholic priest, right? Right? If I ask a Catholic priest to come in here today and tell us what's his view on salvation, tell me if you think he's going to say this. He taught salvation was a personal matter between the individual and God. Of the Roman Catholic system, he said, quote, Aristotle is so in vogue that there is scarcely time in the churches to interpret the gospel. Quote, our hope is the mercy of God and the merits of Christ. Of Jesus Christ, he said, quote, he nailed our sins to the cross, sealed our redemption with his blood. He stated that no rites of the church were necessary for salvation. He said, quote, the way to paradise is the way of the penitent thief. Simply say, thy will be done, the world to me is crucified, and I to the world. Now, you think a Roman Catholic is going to get up and say that for you? No, you're not going to get one. Now, there was a group that was around at his time. They were meeting in little enclaves, and they were known as the Anabaptists. Now, they don't show up in force or in number till the next century. In fact, many times, you know how Bible-oriented Erasmus was? He is called the only Anabaptist of the 16th century. He mentioned them as early as 1523. He makes one of the earliest mentions of the Anabaptists in history. He says he held them in great respect. And this is a strange thing. He made this statement. The Anabaptists that I know, so he knew who they were. He knew them. The Anabaptists that he knew preferred to be called Baptists. Isn't that odd? And I'm not a brighter, but that's wild. All right? And he's also the first person, believe it or not, to use the term fundamental. First time anybody talked about fundamentals, it was Erasmus. There wasn't anybody in Dallas, Texas starting a fundamental movement. But this guy died on July 11th, 1536. The greatest compliment he ever had paid to him was in 1559. I mean, 23 years after he died, he had the greatest compliment ever paid to him. You say, oh, what did the Protestants say about him? Protestants didn't say anything about him. That was the year that the Catholic Pope put all of his writings on the list of the index of forbidden books for Roman Catholics. This as good a Roman Catholic as ever lived, Roman Catholics weren't allowed to read his material. Sound like a good Roman Catholic? So that's the history on Erasmus, and that's the guy who is responsible predominantly for the translation of the Bible that you have, for the translation of Textus Receptus, which you have a copy of in your lap, basically, in your King James Bible. Now, there's another guy that gets blasted. And I think you've heard of this guy. Some of you never heard of Erasmus, but I'm sure you've heard of this fella. And this man's name, and he's got a lot to do with it. Hey, listen, this man's a key man in your Bible, in the translation of your Bible. And here's a guy that we hear a lot of bad about. King James. How many of you have heard that King James was a homosexual? Let me see a hand. How many just heard that he was immoral or something like that? Let me see a hand. That's pretty nice, isn't it? You know what they said about Jesus Christ? We be not what? Born of fornication. All right, the Moody, in the Moody Monthly. In a Moody Monthly, I got the article somewhere in that pile of stuff I got. They had an article about King James where they claimed that he was a homosexual. Wonderful thing. Isn't it funny that the Roman Catholics aren't attacking this guy? You know who's attacking King James? The Bible people. Isn't that strange? All right? King James united the warring tribes of Scotland. And from that built a great kingdom. In Scotland, at the time that King James became the King of Scotland, all you had was a bunch. You remember what he did it years later, Bismarck. Remember all the Germanic tribes that were beating each other's heads in down through Austria and Germany and all that area in there? And listen, Bismarck united all those things and got all the Germanic tribes together and formed Germany. What Bismarck did for Germany, King James did for Scotland. They were nothing but a bunch of head-bashing barbarians up there in Scotland. King James united all them and formed the kingdom known as Scotland. Then he united Scotland with England. And what he did when he did that was he laid the foundation for something that was to be known as the British Empire. He didn't know it. But what he set up was, he set up the network that the King James Bible was going to follow around the world. The British Empire wasn't nothing more but a pipeline. The King James Bible is what went through the pipeline. And he united Scotland and England. He desired for his subjects to have the Bible in their language. As I mentioned the other day, at the time that King James had the King James translation translated, the King James Bible, the church had an English Bible. They had an English Bible. They didn't need another English Bible. And King James never authorized the King James Bible to be read in churches. He never did do that. You know what he read it for? He had it translated for? He had it translated for the same reason that Erasmus translated his Bible into Latin. He did it so that the common man would have the Word of God in his language. Listen, bud, when a king gives his people the Word of God, he's done them the greatest thing. Hey, welfare don't do that for you. He was fluent in Latin, Greek, French, and he was schooled in Italian and Spanish. You know, what you get this idea of is you get this idea of a great big fat guy that doesn't have enough sense to cross the street in the green light and burps around and looks at Playboy magazines all day. That's what you'd think. But that guy's average American. That wasn't King James. Might be the average Greek scholar for all we know. Wrote a tract. We're setting a record on how small chalk can break. You know that? I think that one was a quarter inch right there. That's 3/8 of an inch. He wrote a tract. You know what it was called? Counterblast to Tobacco. He was against smoking. He hated smoking. He wrote a tract against smoking. You know what else he was against? I'm glad you're all sitting down, you Americans. He was against sports. No wonder that crowd's ripping him up. Yeah, he sure was. He was against sports. I mean, man, you know, this guy couldn't have cared less who won the Super Bowl. He didn't care about indoor soccer. He didn't care about golfing. He didn't care about, you know, who hit the home run last night. He didn't care about any of that stuff. He thought it was all wrong. Run around. All he's trying to do, kind of a square guy. He was against tobacco, didn't like sports, and is out there trying to get the Bible in English so everybody can read one. Sounds like a religious fanatic to me. All right? This guy's prime enemy was a man, and this is the guy you want to remember. Anthony Weldon. Anthony Weldon, at one time, had been a member of King James Court. And because of problems of his own, he had to be excluded from the court, and he was kicked out of the King's Court. When Weldon was thrown out, he swore vengeance against King James. He said, I'll bring vengeance on you. Now, the King James was King of England from 1603 to 1625. All right, Weldon swore vengeance against King James. It wasn't until 1650, 25 years after he was dead. It's funny, right around a quarter century after you die, they pay the greatest compliment. In 1650, Weldon wrote a paper in which he claimed that King James was a homosexual. You know why I did that? Dead men never argue. And there were enough people still alive in England 25 years after King James was dead that knew King James that you know what happened to it? Nothing. Nobody paid any attention to it. It was totally ignored. Nobody believed it. Nobody accepted it. And it remained dead until you know when? The 20th century. And somebody wanted to throw another rock at King James and his King James Bible, so a Christian organization, Moody Monthly and all the other crowd, picked it up and started putting around that King James was a homosexual. You know what it is? It was blatant character assassination 25 years after a good man was dead. And listen, what would you do if somebody came in here and said, I just want to let you know that Lester Roloff was a homosexual? Now, if you didn't kill him, you wouldn't believe him, would you? But maybe a couple hundred years from now, if somebody didn't like Roloff and they were searching through history and they just found that at one camp meeting somebody stood up and said Roloff was a homosexual, that's all they'd need to start publishing the report, right? That's all you need. Now, to let you know how much this guy was hated, I told you he became king in 1603, right? Do you know when he told them to start translating the King James Bible? 1604. One of his first acts of official business as king was to have them start translating the King James Bible. Do you know when they almost killed him for it? 1605. In 1605, a letter came to a member of Parliament asking him on the day that Parliament opened not to be in Parliament. He suspected what was true. He showed some of the guards and he showed the king the letter. They went down in the basement of Parliament. See, this guy's about to translate the Bible into English. Who would that scare more than anybody else? What organization would that scare more than anybody else? Roman Catholicism. They went down to the basement of Parliament and they found a guy by the name of Guy Fawkes. Guy Fawkes was standing beside, you'll excuse the expression, a pile of faggots. And that's what it says in history, okay? Faggots are something you burn. Which has a good ring to it, doesn't it? Anyway. When the guards, and there he was with a slow match, which means fuse, and a tinderbox. And when they took Fawkes in hand and got rid of the wood, they found out there was 36 drums, 36 barrels of gunpowder. Fawkes was waiting for the king and Parliament to convene. He was a servant of a Jesuit priest named Henry Garnett. Fawkes was going to light the fuse right off. When Parliament went up and King James was killed, they were going to take the throne of England. They were going to marry King James' son, I believe it was, to a Roman Catholic and restore Rome as the predominant power to England. That was destroyed. That gunpowder plot came to naught. But Henry Garnett, the Jesuit, and Guy Fawkes and several others were later killed. Now, that's two fellas that we hear a lot of bad about. And yet, nobody ever told you that. Kind of like I was telling you about Columbus the other day, right? You know why the public school system never told you anything good about Columbus? They don't want you to know anything good about him. That's why those people aren't going to tell you anything good about Erasmus, and they're not going to tell you anything good about King James. They don't want you to know anything good about him. Now I'm going to talk to you about two guys who are bad guys that all you hear is something good about. And these guys' name, you know, they're about as famous as Smith and Wesson, but only much more deadly, Westcott and Hort. Now, let me simply say this. I mean, in a synopsis, to start off with, Westcott and Hort were two unsaved Anglican priests, all right? They were two lost men who went to hell. I don't say that. You know, when you disagree with somebody, you get in an argument with them, you like to say they're going to hell. Oh, I don't think they're really saved. That's too bad you don't think that. They're still going to heaven. I'm not saying that they went to hell because I disagree with them over what they... when you read what they believe, you'll find out, listen, there was never any testimony of those two men having accepted Christ. The closest man alive today to the beliefs of Westcott and Hort would probably be Robert Schuller, and he's probably not as tainted as them. He's probably not as bad as them. I'm also going to make this statement. The schools and universities that use the Westcott and Hort text, if Westcott and Hort were alive today, those schools would pride themselves in not having men like that on their campus. This is what Hort says about Eden. I'm inclined to think that no such state as Eden, I mean the popular notion, ever existed, and that Adam's fall in no degree differed from the fall of each of his descendants, as Coleridge justly argues. Coleridge was a dopehead that Hort almost worshipped. This is what he said about the infallibility of the Bible. He's talking about when they wanted to sit on the translation committee for the revised version, and he wanted to know, when I sit, you know, to sit on this committee, do I have to believe that the Bible's infallible? Now, I think that'd help. Here's what he said. If you make a decided conviction to the absolute infallibility of the New Testament, practically a sin quo non for a cooperation, I fear I could not join you. He said, if you're going to tell me that I've got to believe that the New Testament is infallible, I can't do it. Here's what he says about the Bible. As I was writing the last words, a note came from Westcott. He too mentions having had fears, which he now pronounces groundless on the strength of our last conversation, in which he discovered that I did recognize providence in biblical writings. Most strongly, I recognize it, but I am not prepared to say that it necessarily involves absolute infallibility. He believed God bumped into the Bible on the way. He said, I cannot say that the Bible is absolutely infallible. Isn't it strange people that use a Westcott and Hort text will stand up and say the Bible is it's absolute and infallible? Isn't that what they use? Isn't that the term they use? Their dad didn't. Quote, but I'm not able to go as far as you, he's writing somebody else, in asserting the absolute infallibility of a canonical writing. This is what he said of Darwin. Darwin was contemporary with Hort. Quote, have you read Darwin? How I should like to talk with you about it. In spite of difficulties, I am inclined to think it unanswerable. In any case, it is a treat to read such a book. How many went to a college where they said that? A Christian college. He made this statement, talking about Darwin. But the book which has most engaged me is Darwin. Whatever may be thought of it, it is a book that one is proud to be contemporary with. My feeling is strong that the theory is unanswerable. If so, it opens up a new period. Now, I would say probably today, closest thing we got to Darwin is probably Carl Pagan over there in Cornell University in New York. And Pagan gets up, you know, and he makes all these statements, these grandiose statements about how, you know, if you've ever read anything Carl Pagan writes, he writes like God. He does. He said, you know, this is how it was, and that's how it is, and you just got... I'm going to tell you some people, I'm not proud to be contemporary with Carl Pagan. We had people who used to go down to my church down the street, preach down in Ithaca, New York, and one of my men saw Pagan on the street, handed him a tract, guy flipped it away from him, didn't want anything to do with it. I don't think that Pagan is unanswerable, and I ain't proud to be contemporary with him, okay? And if I walked around saying I was, what would you want me here to preach you for? He says this concerning hell. I think Maurice's letter to me sufficiently showed that we have no sure knowledge respecting the duration of future punishment, and that the word eternal has a far higher meaning than the merely material one of excessively long duration. Extinction always grates against my mind as something impossible. He says this, certainly, in my case, it proceeds from no personal dread when I have been living most godlessly. You hear what he just said? Him doubting the existence of hell. Certainly, in my case, it proceeds from no personal dread when I have been living most godlessly. Man, I wish we could find out what he was doing in the alleys. I have never been able to frighten myself with visions of a distant future, which I... Bad that this guy says there is no purgatory. But I fully and unwaveringly agree with him in the three cardinal points of the controversy. One, that eternity is independent of duration. Two, that the power of repentance is not limited to this life. Three, that it is not revealed whether or not all will ultimately repent. The modern denial of the second has, I suppose, had more to do with the spiritualizing of theology than almost anything that could be named. This man believed you could repent after you were dead. Do you believe that?
No.
Do they believe that at Bob Jones University? I don't think they do. I really don't think they do. Oh, I wouldn't doubt there's somebody on the faculty probably does. Do they believe that at Liberty University? I don't think it's a stand that they take. I don't think they believe that at Tennessee Temple. Why would you want to use a Greek text translated by this guy? I can ask you a better question. Why would you throw out one translated by a guy named Erasmus with what he was like and pick one up by a guy that believed you could repent after you were dead? The idea of purgation, a cleansing as by fire, seems to me inseparable from what the Bible teaches us of the divine chastisements. And though little is directly said respecting the future state, it seems to me incredible that the divine chastisements should in this respect change their character when this visible life is ended. What's he saying? He's saying that you are punished for your sins after you die and that eventually you get out. Here's what he believed about the atonement. What do you believe about the atonement? See if you line up with him. The fact is, I do not see how God's justice can be satisfied without every man's suffering in his own person the full penalty for his sins. Is that what you believe? Does that sound like a man that got saved? Certainly nothing can be more unscriptural than the modern limiting of Christ bearing our sins and sufferings to his death, and indeed that is only one aspect of an almost universal heresy. That Christ bore your sins and that it was all done on the cross. I guess when Jesus said it was finished, he just didn't know what he was talking about. Listen to this. Let me ask you, who was the ransom paid to? God. I confess I have no repugnance to the primitive doctrine of a ransom paid to Satan. Though neither am I prepared to give full assent to it. But I can see no other possible form in which the doctrine of a ransom is at all tenable. Anything is better than the notion of a ransom paid to the Father. That guy says that Jesus Christ died for the devil. He died and the ransom was paid to the devil. The sacrifice was made to the devil. Do you know what that makes Jesus Christ's sacrifice? That makes it the greatest Satan worship seance that ever took place. The greatest black mass, the greatest anti-God thing there ever was, that was the sacrifice of the Son of God for your sins. That's what Hort believed. Fenton John Anthony Hort. I'll see if I pick something up for you on baptism. Baptism assures us that we are children of God, members of Christ and his body, and heirs to the heavenly kingdom. Is that what you believe? Let me ask you this. If you believe that, would that get you to heaven? This is what he said about America. Now remember, this guy was around right in the middle of the Civil War. I mean, they started that translation, that RV, in 1871. This is what he said in 1862, when the Civil War was just starting. I care more for England and for Europe than for America. How much more than for all the niggers in the world? That's what Hort said. And I contend that the highest morality requires me to do so. Tremendous man, isn't he? I wish somebody would quote him like that at Bob Jones University, don't you? He says this. Oh, some 30 years ago, Niebuhr, good man to quote, wrote to this effect, quote, "Whatever people may say to the contrary, the American Empire is a standing menace to the whole civilization of Europe, and sooner or later one or the other must perish." That was Niebuhr's quote. Here's what Hort says about it. "Every year has, I think, brought fresh proof of the entire truth of these words. American doctrine, only too well echoed from Europe itself, though felt to be at variance with the institutions of Europe, American doctrine destroys the root of everything vitally precious which man has by painful growth," sounds like evolution, "been learning from the earliest times till now. The American Empire seems to me mainly an embodiment of American doctrine, its leading principle being lawless force." Well, I kind of like that part. "Surely, if ever Babylon or Rome were rightly cursed, it cannot be wrong to desire and pray from the bottom of one's heart that the American Union may be shivered to pieces." I'll take Lincoln. He says something in here about black folks I can't read. I won't say that either. I won't tell you what he thought of Moody. Here's what he said. He was doing a study. He said, "I have pretty well made up my mind to devote my 3 or 4 years up here to the study of this subject of communism. I can only say that it was through the region of pure politics that I myself approach communism." Well, no wonder he's so anti-American. I know a whole bunch of communists are anti-American, don't you? Now, would you take this guy's text and teach your Bible college students, your next generation of preachers, from what this guy did to the Greek New Testament? This guy, you know what he believed? He believed that the Bible should be handled just like any other book, any other literary work. Maybe that's why they use it down at Bob Jones. He was a member, him and Westcott started something called the Ghostly Guild. Westcott, Gorham, I don't know if I ought to read this guy's names. Wesley Gorham, C.B. Scott, Benson, Bradshaw, and Leward, etc. "And I have started a society for the investigation of ghosts and all supernatural appearances and effects, being all disposed to believe that such things really exist and ought to be discriminated from hoaxes and mere subjective delusions. We shall be happy to obtain any good accounts, well authenticated with names." And it says, Cope calls us the Cock and Bull Club. "Our own temporary name is the Ghostly Guild." Here's a man that got together and tried to communicate with the dead. And they knocked King James. And they knocked Erasmus. All right, this is Westcott. Westcott said this, talking about, this is about the book of Genesis. "No one now, I suppose, holds that the first 3 chapters of Genesis, for example, give a literary, a literal history. Do you hold that? Do you believe that the first 3 chapters of Genesis give a literal history?" So do I. Westcott didn't. Why would you use his Greek New Testament? He said this, "If you feel now that it was, to speak humanly, necessary for the Lord that the Lord should speak of the sun rising, it was no less necessary that he would use names Moses and David as his contemporaries use them. There is no critical question at issue. Poetry is, I think, 1,000 times more true than history." This man did not believe that Moses or David ever existed in history. He did not believe that those were human, living, walking, talking men. He believed that they were just so much Jewish poetry. Do you believe that? Well, neither did King James, neither did Erasmus. This is what he says about heaven. No doubt, he's talking about the writings of another fellow, but he says this, "No doubt, the language of the rubric is unguarded, but it saves us from the error of connecting the presence of Christ's glorified humanity with place. Heaven is a state and not a place." I got news for you, pal. This guy never went to that state. He pushed socialism. His name was Brooke Floss Westcott, by the way. He was a pacifist. This was his pastime. He used his leisure chiefly in sketching and arranging his collections of ferns and butterflies and moths, and his reading books of natural history or poetry. Ferns, moths, and butterflies. That's exciting. He was an adherent of a Roman Catholic Jesuit-trained poet by the name of Cable. This is what he said about purgatory. A man wrote to him, a young student wrote to him and asked him if it was okay to pray for the dead. I considered very carefully in conference with some other bishops of large knowledge and experience, which is the wrong place to go, isn't it? The attitude of our church, talking about the Anglican Church, with regard to prayers for the dead. Now, at this time, the Anglican Church would not allow prayers for the dead. We agreed unanimously that we, as things are now, that we are forbidden to pray for the dead apart from the whole church in our public services. No restriction is placed upon our private devotions. So what he said was, the church won't let you pray in public for the dead, but if you want to do it by yourself, it's okay. He made a statement. For 30 years, he had been preaching what is called the larger hope. That larger hope is that when Jesus Christ said, I go to prepare in my Father's house are many mansions, Westcott and company believed it said it was this, and this is what it reads in Revised Version. In my Father's house are many abiding places. Those abiding places were resting places where a soul on their journey to heaven rested. Those places in John 14, those mansions, are purgatory. How much did this guy worship Mary? You know what his wife's name was? His wife's name, when they were engaged, was Sarah Louisa Wittard. He made her change her name to Mary. He never called her Sarah. All of his letters, I've got a copy of his life and letters that this stuff's from. He never called his wife Sarah. He called his wife Mary. That's how much he thought of Mary. He believed in a thing called the koinobium. Koinobium. You have heard of this. You even know who practices it. And you didn't like it. This was his dream. This was his dream. He wrote a great deal of his life letters. All he talks about is the koinobium and it coming into fruition. It would consist primarily of an association of families bound together by common principles of life, of work, of devotion, subject during the time of voluntary cooperation to central control, and united by definite obligations. Such a corporate life would be best realized under the conditions of a collegiate union, with halls and schools and chapel, with a common income, though not common property, and an organized government. You know what this guy believed in? He believed in communism. He believed in communal living on a college campus. You've heard of that, haven't you? Today they call them communes. His day they call it a koinobium. Everybody that ever lived in a commune was fulfilling the lifelong dream of Brooke Foss Westcott, translator of the Westcott and Hort Greek text that your New American Standard and the New International and all the other new Bibles are from, that is trumpeted as better than a Textus Receptus. If you pick up a Nestle's Greek text, that is predominantly Westcott and Hort. That's what the guy believed. His son, Arthur, was scared to death of it. He said, my own recollection of the koinobium are very vivid. Whenever we children showed signs of greediness or other selfishness, we were assured that such things would be unheard of in the koinobium. He writes a letter, my dear Benson, alas, I feel most deeply that I ought to not speak one word about the koinobium. One seems to be entangled in the affairs of life. The work must be for those who have a fresh life to give. Yet sometimes I think that I have been faithless to call, which might have grown distinct if I had listened. The paper on the koinobium will appear, I think, in the next number of the Contemporary. Contemporary was a periodical. It was a trial to me not to send it to you and Lightfoot and Wordsworth for criticism, but on the whole, I thought it best to venture for myself and speak simply what I feel. If anything is to come of the idea, it will be handled variously, and something is gained even by incompleteness. on the true reconciliation of classes, I have said a few words which I hope are intelligible. And all through here, this guy, all he talks about is a koinobium. Here's what he believes about miracles in the Bible. I never read an account of a miracle that it seemed instinctively I seem instinctively to feel it in improbability and discover somewhat of evidence in the account of it. He said, whenever I read a miracle in the Bible, I want to find something that proves it wrong. I can't believe that it ever happened. Now, he was a peace lover. In fact, he believed in arbitrary disarmament, unilateral disarmament. He believed that. He believed that all of the nations should get together, strange, and get rid of their weapons. Sound familiar? But he didn't like controversy. I cannot myself reconcile the spirit of controversy and that of Christian faith. You know what I'm talking about? He didn't want to offend anybody. This guy sounds like he'd be the president of every Christian radio station in the country, doesn't he? He could. Now, Bergen. Now, this man would read a fellow by the name of Cable. Cable, like I said, was a Roman Catholic poet. Anti-God. Hort's big man was Coleridge. Coleridge was a dope head. He was an had an opium habit. But this guy wouldn't read Bergen. You know why he wouldn't read John Bergen? John Bergen, also known as Dean Bergen, Dean of Chichester. He wouldn't read John Bergen because Bergen was a Ruckmanite. That's the truth. Bergen was probably everything that Ruckman is today. Bergen was probably the premier scholar of his day. And whenever somebody would say something about Westcott and Hort, he would say, well, it's another excursion into cloudland. He called their theories just so much moonshine. And Bergen was crass and crude. You know what he said? He wouldn't read Bergen. I cannot read Mr. Bergen yet. A glance at one or two sentences leads me to think that his violence answers himself. Who does that sound like? Who does that sound like? I read one or two verses that, you know, that manuscript evidence, or I just couldn't read it because the man's violent too much for me. Well, I'd say they put Doc in a good class. Here's what he says about baptism. I did not say that baptism is absolutely necessary, though from the word of Scripture I can see no exception. You know, I can't find anything in the Bible that says you're not saved by baptism. All right, now there's some other stuff in here about Westcott and Hort, but I'm going to read that to you. Now, that's the bad guys. Now, isn't it strange that you don't hear anything good about Erasmus and you don't hear anything good about King James? You hear all bad about them. Now, who do you think would say something bad about them? Name me an organization that would have something bad to say about them. Yeah, Roman Catholics. Then why is it our Bible-believing crowd that's cutting them up? Why is it people who stand up and say, I believe the Bible is the infallible, perfect Word of God, why is it that a university, no matter how unusual it is, can, it's not unusual at all, everybody takes that stand. We'll stand up and say, we stand on the old, you know, the Bible without apology, we stand on the authority of Scripture. Why would they say something bad about Erasmus when you heard what you heard about him? Why would they say something bad about King James when you heard what you heard about him? And why would they not say something bad about Westcott and Hort? Listen, that stand that they take, there's not a Roman Catholic Jesuit in the world that wouldn't take that stand. Westcott and Hort were a couple of lost Roman Catholics. All right, now let me just tell you a little bit about some of the translators of the King James Bible. I won't go into depth. And if you want to get a good thing, there's two books called Translators Revived and The Men of the KJV. And one is by... Translators Revived is by a guy, I think it's named Edward McClure. I know it's McClure. And the other guy's name is Gustavus Payne, Men of the King James Version. You ought to get both those books and read them. All right? Here's what Dr. Lancelot Andrews, was a translator for King James. This is what they said of him. Once a year at Easter, he used to pass a month with his parents. During this vacation, month-long vacation. Boy, I'll tell you what, guys got it soft, don't you think? Wouldn't you guys like a month-long vacation? Here's what he did during his vacation. He water skied, he rode his rubber ducky, he went windsurf. During this vacation, he would find a master from whom he learned some language to which he was a stranger. In this way, after a few years, he acquired most of the modern languages of Europe. Is that what you guys do on your vacation? You take a vacation, go learn a foreign language in 30 days? I don't think you've got the mind for it, and I know I haven't. It says this. He was not a man of head knowledge only. He was a man of great practical preaching ability and an ardent opponent of Rome. His conspicuous talents soon gained him powerful patrons. Henry, Earl of Huntingdon, took him to the north of England, where he was the means of converting many papists by his preaching and disputations. Let me stop here to say one thing about the King James translators. These men from here up, from the neck up, these men were entirely and completely qualified to do the work they did. They had the necessary education. But I also want you to know that right here in the chest, they had a personal heart. These men, every one of these men, you'll find out, were not just head men, but these men went out and were anti-Roman and did personal soul winning. As a preacher, Bishop Andrews was right famous in his day. He was called the Star of Preachers. He made this statement, to have prayed well is to have studied well. There's one fellow here I wanted to... Andrews was conversant in 15 languages. Hey, he was the Bishop of Rochester. There's another bishop there now. John Overall. John Overall was at the court of Winchester when they killed Henry Garnett. Henry Garnett was the Jesuit that tried to blow up the king. And Overall went out there and tried to win the guy to Christ. Isn't that something? John Overall disputed in favor of the Johnine comma. The Johnine comma is 1 John 5:7. Henry Saravia was sent by Queen Elizabeth's council as a missionary to the islands of Guernsey and Jersey, where he was one of the first Protestant ministers, knowing, as he says of himself in a letter, which were the beginnings and by what means and occasions the preaching of God's word was planted there. You had a missionary. And that's something. You had a missionary on the translation committee of the King James Bible. John Layfield, being skilled in architecture, his judgment was much relied on for the fabric of the tabernacle and temple. Robert Teague was an excellent textuary and profound linguist. William Bedwell, quote, an intimate Oriental scholar. His epitaph mentions that for the Eastern tongues, as learned a man as most lived in these modern times. This guy published a quarto in addition of the epistles of St. John in Arabic with a Latin version. Can you imagine that? This guy translated the thing into Arabic with a Latin edition with it. I'd like to see some of the guys on the New King James Translation Committee do that. Wouldn't you? I'll tell you something, folks. Let me show you something. Now, this is logic, and this is Sam Gipp's logic. And I always say that whenever our logic, you have logic, I have logic, but if it goes contrary to Scripture, we've got to throw it out. Now, let's just arbitrarily pick a date in time. Oh, let's say right around 1611. Okay, now let's pick another arbitrary date. Let's say 1988. Now, morality. Has it gone uphill or downhill? You believe this world's degenerating? You think morality has gone downhill? That's what you're telling me. Okay. Oh, let's think of something else. What about law and order? Has that gone uphill or downhill?
Downhill.
Downhill? What about man's character? The character of men. You know, just the metal they're made of. Uphill or downhill? Do you think men are more men now than they were 400 years ago? You guys are too negative. Let me see if I can break one of these into 18 pieces quick. Tell me something else. What about organized governments? Music? Oh, there's a good one. Music. Has music degenerated or has it gotten better? Well, give me a vote. Downhill. Down, kill. So I'll give you another one. Art? Hey, there's a good one. I mean, Picasso, he's an improvement. Man, I've seen a picture of a garbage dump that made more sense than what Picasso's done. Got puce on a canvas and somebody buys it. I think, you know what I think? I think that thing over there in Chicago is the greatest joke that's ever been played on a city. That Picasso sculpture. That dog waiting for the RCA guy to talk in his ear. Everything has degenerated, right? Do you know what Christians believe? Christians believe education's gotten better. Isn't that true? Now you tell me, has education gotten better?
No.
Has it degenerated?
Yes.
Education has gone downhill along with the rest of society. Now you tell me how you could find men that are as qualified in 1988 as they were in 1611. It is impossible, people, if you believe that the world is degenerating. And you know something? The men that sat in the translation committee of the New King James Bible believe that everything on that board is degenerating. And you know what they'll say about education? Yes, it's degenerating, but Christian education is getting better. Oh, yeah. Go look at your Christian school. Took my kids out of a Christian school. Three of the girls in the class got pregnant that year, and one of the boys walking around with a punk haircut. Yeah, Christian schools have just, boy, we've turned the country around, haven't we? Yes, sir. That just means we sink belly up instead of belly down, that's all. You don't have, listen, it is impossible. It is impossible amongst King James Bible believers to find all of the scholars that would meet one of these guys. It's impossible. You know what I, you know the illustration I used? I had this little Chevette. And I took this, big Chevy. Let me tell you about this Chevy first. I think I was telling you the other day, I had this 74 Chevy, this old state patrol car. And it had a 454. It was fun. Really merged with traffic. And so I took that thing out one day, and just for the fun of it, you know, I booted it down to see what it'd do. I got out of it at 115 because I was catching up on all these cars. You know, these people get on the road and they mess you up. So at 115, now that thing was working just as hard as it could, and I mean, it was still going to keep on going, but I got out of it at 115. I paid $1,200 for that car. It was a great big four-door. When I got rid of that car, I bought a Chevette. I got half the car for twice the price. My Chevette was a two-door. My big Chevy was a four-door. It had a four-cylinder instead of a V8. It cost me $2,400 instead of $1,200. I got exactly half the car for twice the price. And one day, just for the fun of it, I took it out and I booted it down. Booted it down. I laid a brick there and went to sleep. And with a good tailwind, I kicked that thing down and let it just wind out, and 2 hours and 15 minutes later, I broke 80 miles an hour. Now, let me ask you a question. Which car was working harder? They're both the same. If I asked you which one was going faster, the big Chevy was going faster. Both of them were working as hard as they could, right? But that Chevette is never going to attain what that big 454 could attain, right? Listen, that big 454 wasn't working any harder than that Chevette was. They were both working as hard as they possibly could. You know what I'm telling you? I'm telling you that you get the scholar today. I don't care, lost, saved, Bible-believing or non-Bible-believing, they can put their minds together and work as hard as they can. They'll never get to 115 miles an hour. They'll never get to 1,611 miles an hour. They will never attain. They cannot. It's not in man anymore. Why in the world would you want somebody to translate a Bible in the 20th century in America? Can you stop thinking about that? In the generation of age, you want a Bible that's been translated. With a guy that says that the Pope is a good fellow and you ought to see a movie about him. And you're going to pick up a New King James Bible because it's easier to read. Man, you need a coloring book. Bedwell, he not only had St. John in Arabic and a Latin version, he also wrote a Persian dictionary. How many of you wrote a dictionary? Anybody here write a dictionary? How about a dictionary of foreign language? I did a coloring book in a foreign language. Sit down, you'll think about that after a while. Bedwell, listen to this, had a fondness for mathematical studies. He invented a ruler for geometrical purposes, like what we call Gunther scale, which went by the name Bedwell's ruler. This guy invented a mathematical ruler for doing mathematical equations. That didn't have nothing to do with his translation work. Lawrence Chatterton. Oh, wait, let me give you Edward Lively. Edward Lively, one of the best linguists in the world, much dependence was placed on his surpassing skill in Oriental languages. All right, Lawrence Chatterton. Lawrence Chatterton was raised Roman Catholic, encouraged by his family to become a lawyer. He traveled to London, where he was converted to Christ and joined the Puritan congregation there. Who told you there's a bunch of Anglican Episcopalians? Somebody said the King James translators were a bunch of Episcopalian baby sprinklers. Or, no, they weren't. Lawrence Chatterton was Puritan. So who's Puritan? That's the guys that are kinfolks. He made himself familiar with the Latin, Greek, and Hebrew tongues and was thoroughly skilled in them. Moreover, he had diligently investigated the numerous writings of the rabbis so far as they seemed to promise any aid to the understanding of Scripture. Chatterton, now get this. This man's a scholar, right? Chatterton was a powerful preacher who lived to the age of 103. A preaching engagement in his latter years was described as... Now, please don't get me wrong. There have been some great men live, and they've lived a long time, some of them too long. Have you ever heard some of them preach? I'm not going to mention anybody by name, but I saw a fellow one time come to the pulpit, and he said this. I mean, you know, and everybody else said this. This guy in his old age was preaching to a congregation, having addressed his audience for 2 full hours by the glass. He paused and said, "I will no longer trespass on your patience." And the whole congregation cried with one consent, "For God's sake, go on." He accordingly proceeded much longer to their great satisfaction and delight. This guy lived to be 103 years old. Now, I'm not trying to inspire Rex Harrison to try to break the two-hour sound barrier. But this guy lived to be 103. You break 2 hours, you won't live to be 103, brother. I'll guarantee you that right now. We'll rust your braces. But God lived to be 103, but when he was old man, he got up and preached for 2 full hours when he said, "Oh man, listen, I preached too long." They said, "Keep on going." It says, let me see. Here's a guy. For all that I've said about a guy named Benson, here's a fellow named Thomas Harrison. Yes. Thomas Harrison, it is recorded, was chosen to assist King James translation due to his knowledge of Greek and Hebrew. In fact, his ability served him well in his duties as vice master of Trinity College in Cambridge. Quote, "On account of his exquisite skill in Hebrew and Greek idioms, he was one of the chief examiners in the university for those who sought to be public professors of these languages." John Reynolds. John Reynolds, as Chatterton, was a Roman Catholic who trusted Jesus Christ and became a Puritan. Says he determined to explore the whole field and make himself master of the subject. He devoted himself to the study of scriptures in the original tongues and read all the Latin, the Greek and Latin fathers and all the ancient records of the church. Now people, that right there is a clue. The Greek and Latin fathers, the early church fathers, and excuse me for using the term fathers, that's the one everybody accepts, you understand it. We're not talking about a bunch of Catholic priests. But the early church fathers give a great deal of credence to our King James Bible, and they're totally ignored by Westcott and Hort. Listen to this. About the year 1578, John Hart, a popish zealot, challenged all the learned men in the nation to a public debate. What's that Catholic's name out there, brother, in California? That Doc debated? You were out there. Bates? Who's that guy that... Carl Keating. A Roman Catholic zealot, wouldn't you say? Publishing, challenging a bunch of Bible believers to a debate. If you've ever seen that debate, it's a joke. About the year 1578, John Hart, a popish zealot, challenged all the learned men in the nation to a public debate. At the solicitation of one of Queen Elizabeth's privy councils, Mr. Reynolds encountered him. After several combats, the Romish champion owned himself driven from the field. Do you realize what that statement, where that statement puts a senile Dr. Ruckman? I'm not trying to exalt that fellow, but do you realize where that puts him? People talk that guy's being senile. I'm trying to get that senile. Richard Kelby. Richard Kelby. This is a quote from David O. Spurr's Which Bible. Here's what it says. I must stop my reader here to tell you that this Dr. Kelby was a man so great in learning and wisdom and so excellent a critic in the Hebrew tongue that he was made professor of it in this university and also perfect Grecian, and that he was by King James appointed to be one of the translators of the Bible. And that this Dr. Kelby and Mr. Sanderson had frequent discourses and loved as father and son. The doctor was to ride a journey to Derbyshire and took Mr. Sanderson to bear his company. And they, resting on a Sunday with the doctor's friend and going together to the parish church where they were, now get what we're about to say, found the young preacher to have no more discretion than to waste a great part of the hour allotted for his sermon in exceptions against the late translation of several words. It was a young preacher who got up and ripped the King James Bible apart. Guy had just been out of college, maybe, you know, where they taught him that there was something wrong with it. Not expecting this guy. Here, what he's doing is he's knocking the King James Bible. This is, I don't have a date on this, but this is shortly after the King James Bible was translated, and out in the congregation is Kelby, who was a translator of the King James Bible. And he didn't know that Kelby was there. All right? And showed three reasons, and you want to remember this lesson, why a particular word should have been otherwise translated. Same game. This week, I'm going to teach you the Greek game. I'm going to teach you how many of you are, say, 14 years or older. If you're 14 years old, you can be a Greek scholar. I'll show you this week. In a half an hour, I'll show you how to be a Greek scholar if you're 14 years old. Now, you can probably do it if you're younger. But if you're 14, and the reason I say 14 is because that's the youngest Greek scholar I ever found. I'll tell you about him later, maybe Friday, tomorrow. Anyway, this guy showed three reasons why a particular word should have been otherwise translated. When evening prayer was ended, the preacher was invited to the doctor's friend's house, where after some other confidence, the doctor told him he might have preached more useful doctrine and not have filled his audience's ears with needless exceptions against the translation. For that word, for which he offered to that poor congregation three reasons why it ought to have been translated as he and others had considered all them, should have been translated as he and others had considered all them, and found 13 more considerable reasons why it was translated as now printed. You know, if you've had any Greek, you know what you do when you read that King James Bible? You come across something, you'll say, God, why is that translated that way? I do. And I say, you know, Lord, that could have been. And then I remember, I say, well, you know, maybe they considered what I just thought it could have been. And they probably got about 150 reasons why it is what it is. People, if you've ever translated from one language to another, you know that any word can be translated four or five different ways, right? The question of proper translation ended in 1611. Okay? The choices were made in 1611. There's no other choices. We don't care about your opinion. We don't care about what your Greek professor said. I don't care what your dad. I don't care if you're a long-lost relative of Westcott and Hoare. If you were, you better get saved. It'd be nice to have one of those guys in heaven. At least one of their names in heaven. All right, let me see if I can give you this guy. Henry Saville. He was so well known for his education, skilled with language and knowledge of the word, that he became Greek and mathematical tutor to Queen Elizabeth during the reign of her father, Henry VIII. He is chiefly known, however, by being the first to edit the complete works of John Chrysostom, the most famous of the Greek fathers. I've got some stuff on some other fellows, bad guys I won't read to you. Now, people, very basically, you've seen the good guys, the bad guys, and the good guys. Erasmus is a good guy. King James is a good guy. John Layfield and Lawrence Chatterton and Miles Smith and every other King James translator, they're good guys. You know what I can't understand? I can't understand why anybody would not... I can't understand why these universities don't tell you something about those men. I don't understand why they don't tell you something bad about Westcott and Hort. They're sure quick to tell you something bad about Ruckman. Right? They sure want to protect you from something. Why don't they protect you from Westcott and Hort? Listen, let me ask you a question. If you started reading the writings of a man who believed that heaven was a state of mind, if you started reading the writings of a man who was a communist, if you started reading the writings of a man that believed that Moses and David did not exist, and a friend knew all that, wouldn't you appreciate if they pointed that out to you? And instead they got up and said, oh, he's great, yeah, you'll like that fella. Now let me give you one more thing to think about. You ever hear anybody say, well, a translation can't possibly be good as the original? You ever hear that? You ever heard somebody say that? What's your final authority on matters of faith and practice? I don't know if I have them written down, but there's three times the word translation appears in your Bible. Do you know that all three times the translation is better than the original? The first time the word translation appears in your Bible is when Amasa is going to translate the kingdom from Ishbosheth to David. Remember when he grabbed Ishbosheth and he said, I'll tell you what, was Amasa or Abner? Abner, okay. Abner got mad at Ishbosheth. You know what he said? He said, I'm going to translate your kingdom to David because it was his from the Lord. Now you tell me, was it better to have a split kingdom with David over 10 tribes or part of the tribes and Ishbosheth over part of it? Or was it better for the man that God chose to have the whole thing? Which was better? Man, so the translation was better than the original. Right? The next translation, I believe it's Colossians, and it talks about us being translated spiritually. We're going to be translated. Now, let me ask you something. How many of you have aches and pains and dirty thoughts and smell bad when you don't take a bath? How many of you? A few of you have obtained nirvana, it looks like. You won't be like that in the translation. Let me ask you something. Is the translation or the original better? The translation's better. And the other translation, which is found in Hebrews chapter 11, was the translation of Enoch. And what did the Bible say? The Bible says God translated him that he might not see death. Now the body that he had would have died. The one he has now will not die. Which is better? The translation is better. So when somebody says, I don't think a translation can be better than the original, tell them that's your problem. You don't think. That's their problem. In fact, if they have a problem, the problem is that they do think. The fact is, whether they think or not, it doesn't matter. Now, I'm going to tell you, you show that to somebody who says, you show those three places in Scripture to somebody who doesn't believe a translation can be better than the original, you know what they'll tell you? I still don't think that a translation be better than the original. Say, thank you. I just want to prove that you did not accept the Bible as your final authority in all matters of faith and practice. That's all. People listen. You either accept it or you don't. But everybody out there saying, have you ever met anybody that was dishonest? Have you ever met anybody that tried to get you that they believed something that they didn't believe? You ever talked to a salesman? Did he hook you? You ever been hooked by, you need to be hooked by a salesman. You need to walk out with a, I shouldn't say this, probably somebody's bought one. You need to spend $900 for a $300 sweeper. That's what you need to do. And it slices and dices and paints the house and dries your hair and changes the baby and everything else. And you walk out and you say, what's a good sweeper? Yeah, it's worth about $200-$300. Yeah, but I paid $1,100 for it. I traded my car, my piano, and two kids. You know. No, I'd get a sweep if I could trade two of the kids. Anyway, the fact is this, people. If somebody gets up and says they believe the Bible is the infallible, perfect Word of God, don't believe it. And if they say, I accept this Bible as my final authority in all matters of faith and practice, don't be so stupid as walk around saying, they accept the Bible as their final authority in all matters of faith and practice. That doesn't mean they do. What's the old song? You know, everybody's singing about heaven ain't going there. Well, everybody talking about believing that book ain't a believing it.
Right.
And you would be surprised how many people say, I believe the King James Bible is infallible, perfect Word of God. Don't believe the King James Bible is infallible, perfect Word of God. And I'm not knocking the guy, but you get J.J. Ray's book on God Wrote Only One Bible. That's a good book. J.J. Ray doesn't believe the King James Bible is the Word of God, folks. J.J. Ray plainly says there are two different places that we need a new translation of the Textus Receptus. He's a Textus Receptus man. He believes the Textus Receptus is perfect. The King James has some problems. I'll take the
In God the Father and Jesus Christ are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. Wisdom and knowledge, wouldn't you like more? What should you do? Colossians 2, 3, and 4. Spend time with God and with Jesus the Son. Don't be led astray by anyone. In God the Father and Jesus Christ are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. In God the Father and Jesus Christ are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words.